Over there. And we're on. So, good morning. Good morning,
Good
Trish.
morning.
Turn your sound up just a little bit. Barely hear you there.
Okay.
Oh, that's much better. Much better. So, here we are. And we're Patricia Wall. I call her Trish. I would try hard to call her Patricia, but it'd sound very, very weird.
It
I'm
would.
Elaine Lindsay of Truel Social Media, and Trish's company is TTLO Inc. That's Take the Lid Off. My son, a long, long time ago, dubbed Trish the Holistic Missile. And believe you me, the hat really fits. So we've decided to start this show called Let's Engage, which is tips for engaging both online and in real life. We just say life, but I think you're going to find it really, really interesting because Trish can go really deep and help you with all kinds of things from your relationships to your business marketing. I'm the one with the social media search engine optimization and some website hats, but Trish is the one that will really take it and help you ramp it up. Good enough intro?
That's a wonderful intro. Thank you.
Oh, you're very welcome. So, without further ado, we have What No Website. That's a very, very cool tagline, I have to say. Joomla Web Design Hosting. Well, good morning. Happy to see you. Don't know your first name, so, and I don't want to just call you What, which sounds a bit bizarre. But yeah, we have one social media, one What. Okay. And zero awesome. Oh, cool. Anyway.
And a
So,
number.
it's February already. Can you believe that? Wow.
It's okay because we're counting off winter. I'm good with that, okay?
Yeah. For people who may watch this later, we are in Canada. We're up in Ottawa, and we have quite frankly, bizarre winters. Okay, it can go from minus 40 to plus 10, depending on where you are. It's currently plus 4. We had
Celsius, that's
ice and
Celsius.
snow, and it was minus 18 on Saturday. So there can be some really bizarre dips. We're supposed to get lots and lots of rain this week. And yeah, absolutely. Tons and tons. So not gonna knock it. It'll get rid of the snow that we have, so that's a good thing. But when it freezes after, it's kind of uncomfortable because we then end up with all kinds of black ice under everything. But let's get more to the point of our show, which is really being able to engage, whether you're online, whether it's in real life. Engaging is the key for me, not just to marketing your product, but engaging is the key to being a part of the world. Am I not right?
And I think that it's part of defining who you are in the world as well. Because everything you do about engaging, you have to decide who you are presenting to the world. And sometimes that's about what's your professional face, what's your personal face. We hope that they can comfortably be similar. I do know that, when I was thinking about what does it mean to engage professionally as opposed to personally? It means that, I know you don't answer the phone, yo.
Yeah.
You have to figure out what you're presenting to the world. And that's really, really true in social media.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's really interesting you say that because I was reading Scott Monty's blog this morning, and he's taught they did the latest statistics talks about what people really want, what are they looking for right now, and what they're looking for is two things: really good quality and being real. Okay, it's about honesty and truth and authenticity, and so a lot of people tend to think that those are buzzwords, but in fact, it's true. Okay, you see time and time again, big companies get in trouble for some of the things they do because it is so inauthentic. And for people to know, Scott Monty, when I first knew him, he was the head of social media for Ford in the States. And Scott Monty really taught people how to do social and do social well, especially for a huge company like Ford. And Scott's gone on to do even more. He's absolutely brilliant in marketing and social and to me, all things. Yeah, I'm a bit of a fangirl, let's face it. But his blog and his new The Full Monty, which you can find on Flipboard, really has some of the best information about what's going on, not just in the marketing world online, but outside of that as well. So it's always good to see these things, but that's exactly why we're here, because it is all about, being real and the quality that we put out, the relevance of what you're putting out is not just important to the search engines, it's important to the consumer. Okay, yes, there's tons and tons and tons of information, but people are so inundated. They are so overwhelmed by the sheer volume of what's out there. Isn't it maybe a little better to give people better quality information, maybe less of it, so that they can have time to digest it? And, let's look at that from your perspective, Trish.
Well, I actually think I want to grab that, give them less information, better quality, because one of the things I see on social media is a lot of TMI, a lot of too much information. So part of what you have to think about when you consider having a persona, presenting yourself online, is what are the lines for you? And you have to think about that. You have to think about that offline. If you haven't figured out what your lines are, then you're going to have sort of knee-jerk reactions when you respond to things. And one, that's unprofessional, but two, it's also often just too personal. So I want you to think about, do you want to talk about what your religion is online? Do you want to talk about how you vote online? Think about what parts of your sense of humor that you would actually put online, as opposed to, keeping to a place where things are not recorded forever the way they are on the internet. And frankly, you can open your kimono and put it all out there. That's entirely up to you. What I'm asking you to do is decide that. Decide what you're presenting to the world. Decide. I was talking to someone yesterday and she said, I don't have a picture. And I said, you need to have a picture. It doesn't have to be you. And she said, well, you know what disturbs me? She said, I see people put up pictures of their kids. And I think, why would you want to have pictures of your kids available in public like that? That to me seems just a little bit dangerous. Puppies, maybe? Picture your furry kids? Not so much. Like that would be fine. Picture your car. Go right ahead. Without your license plate. Without your license plate. Okay. But, you don't have to have a picture of you.
That's
Please
not
don't put up
true.
pictures of your kids.
No, I'm going to stop you there because the one thing people have to do, and I'm glad you brought that up, your profile picture has to be you. It has to
If
be,
you're in business,
yes, in business. Absolutely.
if you're not in
Absolutely.
business,
That's a
you can
really
put up a
good
picture of a
point.
tree. If you're
That's
not
a
in business, you can
really
put up a
good
picture of a
point.
tree. Okay, and you and I know, because if I did everything you tell me, I would be much more advanced in my social media than I am. Bad, bad, bad. I admit it. Okay, I take it. It took you forever to convince me to put my picture up, and I did. If you're in business, you need to, because people need to be able to see your face. If you're not, put up a picture of a tree. Find a cartoon. Take a picture of your dog. Please, not your kids.
No, and that's a really good distinction, but it's important from a business perspective to understand that that headshot, that's who you're presenting to the world. And it's really important that you're consistent in who you're presenting. And you're absolutely right. There is TMI, and there are subjects that we shouldn't all touch on, especially when you're in business. But the fact is, I spoke to someone on Saturday, and they're in the fitness and health and like bodybuilding and what have you. But this person was concerned that their take on life and their blog might be a little different than what people expected. And she said to me, the average businessman or businesswoman may not find that appropriate. So my next question was, and are they your target market?
Yeah, that's and it she exactly. Said,
well, no, they're not. I said, then it really doesn't matter. You will attract the people that are looking for what you offer. And if you know, this is key. If you know your target market and you service your target market well, then absolutely all the pieces of you that are real are great. And I did, I took a look yesterday. And yeah, she's absolutely right. There are things that would not appeal to, traditional three-piece suited businessmen, but that's not her clientele. So it's kind of irrelevant.
Well, and I got to tell you, what happens when those three-piece suited businessmen go home and take off their tie? You don't know who they are.
Yeah, but in the terms of... There's a very when you understand your target market, and especially in like bodybuilding and that kind of fitness, there's a very set window of age range, say, that you're going to deal with. So that sort of defines that target market. And yeah, because he's got a three-piece suit, that's really not the only criteria. Thanks for pulling me up on that, because it's true. But it's the traditional, very old school attitude that may not use the same linguistics as what's put out in this particular blog. So so there are a lot of criteria that go into defining your target market. It's not just the business suit. Good point.
Well, and so now we go back to make your decision. Because that's what this client had to do. She had to sit down and say, okay, so who is it that I show to the world? And is it open kimono? Do I tell them my beliefs, my values? That's an important thing. I think if you're a business person, you have to tell people some of your beliefs and values because they want to know who they're dealing with. It doesn't mean you have to tell them all your business. And it's, what's that line? What's the line of too much information? And so you need to define it. What's TMI for your business? What's TMI personally? What's TMI for your family? One of the things I had to do as I started to engage with social media is I went around and I talked to each person of my active interactions in my family and said, what's okay, what's not okay? Is it okay if I post a picture with you in it? Is it okay if I mention you? And I discussed that with each of them, because it's not appropriate for me to just blab about their life on my social channels. So I had that conversation with them because it's their life, right? And I've also said to the people around me, if you're taking pictures because I'm at, if I'm at some social event and you're taking pictures, don't post them. Yeah. Don't post them without asking me or showing me, because that's respecting my privacy. And
And that's actually, that's a really important point. And you can probably speak to this too, because going to events and all kinds of people are taking pictures, that people are going to put them online. I think people should be asking before they post. Even when I do, you know, first video chats with people in whatever platform, I always ask them, is it okay for me to put up this picture for you? Because yeah, you have to allow them to choose. They're in the picture. But more to the point, okay, people have to understand also when you're taking pictures or you're taking video or what have you at an event and someone's presenting at that event, you have to check with that person if it's okay for you to either photograph or videotape what they're presenting. This is an issue that came up for another client a while back. But someone, and it turns out the person just didn't know any better, but was posting entire reels of this person's presentation. And, you know, when you speak in public and you speak often, you have certain, you know, certain setups, mannerisms, certain pieces of your speeches. That's how you get paid. Okay, that's part of your persona as a speaker. And having someone, you know, not thinking and taking that basically in toto and putting it up online without asking is absolutely a no-no. And it's made things more difficult for people in the business world because people don't understand the rules, okay? Social media, you know, it's still a little bit of the Wild West. There are not set rules. There's not, you know, there's not specific boundaries that have been laid out. People just assume that people will use common sense. But often...
Good luck.
yeah. And often people just, you know, they really are enjoying something. They don't realize, you know, that there are not just privacy issues, but ownership rights involved with that. So it's often something that I think I tell clients that it's important that you specify your rules. And if you're doing a talk, then you need to specify that at the beginning or end of your talk, or perhaps both in some cases, that your property is your own. And the only way it gets put out there is by you.
Yes. I think also we have to understand, you know, one of the things that the internet has done has blurred the boundaries of ownership. Because, you know, it used to be, I remember, you know, in a business office talking to someone and saying, you know, if you go to the supply cabinet and take a handful of pens and then bring them home for your kids to use at school, that's actually theft.
Yeah.
And I remember her eyes got this big because she just hadn't thought about it. They were just pens.
Yeah.
But they don't belong to you. You know, the company buys them. They provide them for your use at work. They don't provide them, you know, we're not buying school supplies for your kids. And people sometimes just don't think. And so in the same way, people will record their favorite TV show and put it up on YouTube. And, you know, YouTube will often take these things down because, oh, no, you don't own the copyright of that. We'll just take that down. you know, but it can take a while. People just don't think. It's that, oh, I just want to share. I want to share. I want to give. I want to share. And they're not thinking that the thing that they want to share and give is not theirs to share.
Yeah.
In the same way, it's not mine to share pictures of my kids if they don't want that.
Yeah, no, absolutely correct. And you know, I have what I call glam kids because I'm a glam ma. And I always check with my kids, is it all right to post pictures of the glam kids? Now, they post them, so that's quite often it is okay. But it's important that you check with other people. And the thing is, in business, it's different for someone that's posting on Facebook that, say, you know, went out to a restaurant with a bunch of people and took pictures, and you still, common courtesy dictates that you should ask before posting a picture of someone. Some people, me included, can be really put off by pictures of themselves and it's always better to get the permission. But from a business standpoint, it's much more strict than that. You know, there are companies like Getty Images and Shutterstock and that own all the pictures that people you'll often see will post on social media, not understanding that from a business perspective, you don't own that. And if you don't buy a copy of the picture, you can, in fact, get in trouble. And that works for, you know, pictures, it works for video, it works for whatever. But the other thing that people seem to lose sight of is the fact that once it's out there forever. Okay, if you put something up and you take it down 10 minutes later, well, good on you. But guess what? It's up there. You're not, you know, somebody who, you know, hackers are pretty smart. And someone with a fair amount of tech savvy can go find that photo or video or text or whatever you put up there. So it's really important, even for people that are just posting in a friendly way, to always be aware, like, what you're putting up, that's there for good. And Mari Smith used to say, you know, post it only if you wouldn't mind your grandmother seeing it, you wouldn't mind seeing it on the front page of the New York Times, and there's nothing that is truly offensive to any individual person. So, you know, that to me is sort of a basic rule of thumb.
Yep. And there's also, you know, I think people have caught on to the fact that potential employers now go check your social media. So a lot of people have, you know, cleaned up the Saturday night drunk pictures and stuff that might have been there, realizing that this is not going to get me a job. That doesn't mean that they can control what their friends post, who may not have figured that out and think it's, you know, a hilarious thing to post the picture of their friend who had one too many. So it's remembering that people can go look at this stuff. Now, I know you've taught me that there are permissions that you can set so the public can't just go look at your stuff. You know, if you haven't friended them or connected to them, you know, in whatever way the social media channel allows, they can't just go see everything. Not everybody remembers that. And I think it's a really important point for people to recognize that their children, you know, their friends may not have the same privacy settings they do. And so if they're posting things that, you know, I mean, if you're in business, unless you're in the bodybuilder business, you may not want you at the beach with your kids posted. You know, you just don't want to be revealed in all your glory to people you're doing business with. So then the other thing I wanted to think about, I wanted people to think about, this is something that you taught me too, which is because I'm very much on social media, to connect with people and my clients and things like that. You know, typically if people say, oh, you know, friend me or whatever like that, I just, oh, sure, you know. And I learned really quickly that that was a bad idea. That if you just accept a friend request from anybody, you soon have to block them. And so what you taught me, and I've been using this ever since, is if someone you don't know makes a friend request, then you say, hi, who are you? You know, why did you want a friend request? And invite them to just follow your business page. Oh, yeah. Totally different frame of mind for interaction. Totally different. Because I think, and I certainly did, you know, I thought, okay, if I'm going on social media so that I can connect with people, then I'm out there to connect. That doesn't mean that my personal profile is the place that I have to connect. And that was something that hadn't sunk in until we had that conversation.
Yeah. And okay, I just want to clarify that because you friend people on Facebook. So the very nature of what it's called, on LinkedIn, you connect, on Twitter, you follow, you know, in Google Plus, you put people in circles, but you're actually following them. Only Facebook uses the term friend. And I think it's important from a personal profile standard that people understand that. There are a lot of people that ask to be friends, but if you want to maintain just, you know, lots of people, family and friends only on Facebook on their personal profile. That's why they have a business page. And that way, if you have, you know, tightened your security and your privacy is set for just friends and family, you have to make your friends aware that that's how your settings are. Because even though you get told, if you try to share something that someone shared with you and they've only shared it with friends, you'll get a warning telling you that was not shared. On Google Plus, it asks you to please be considerate. On Facebook, sometimes you can still get around that and share it with the public. So it's really important, if the importance to you is maintaining only friends and family, then that has to be in your about section on Facebook, and you have to let your friends know, I'm friending you, but please be aware, here is what I accept and do not accept on this platform. It's just like in life, okay? We have boundaries. Although I'm happy to see my friends all the time, don't show up at my door at 3 a.m., please. Okay, that's not, you know, that doesn't make sense. And we do have boundaries that we think people know and understand. But you kind of have to set those in place, even in your own head, knowing what is and isn't appropriate.
Now we're back to
online, decide. Offline.
decide before you engage. Decide yeah. before you engage what your lines are so that you're not left flat-footed. So you're not left going, well, I don't know. Maybe this is okay. They seem to think it's okay. You know, and it's important to decide what your values are for these kinds of interactions, because if you haven't thought that through before you engage, you're going to be interacting with people who don't have the same values as you do. People who think it's perfectly reasonable to send you direct messages, you know, with pictures you don't want to see. People who think it's perfectly reasonable to find whatever contact information that you've put in your profile yeah. and abuse it. What we think of as common sense isn't common. You know, what we think of as common courtesy isn't common. And what we think of as appropriate isn't universal.
Yeah, and absolutely, like different things are viable in different cultures. You know, there are different limits everywhere. I always suggest to people, especially if you're in business and you're using social for business and you're using part of social not for business, then I think it's really important that you distinguish those two. Hi, William. Why do people feel it's reasonable to send you a sales pitch when you thank them for following me on Twitter? Such a good question. Such a good comment, William. I'm so with you on that. Not only that, and this is something that I tell all my clients and something I try to do 100% of the time. Okay. If someone sends you a direct message on Twitter, well, you know what? Go look at their profile. Find out what they do. But right off the bat, it is never appropriate to pitch somebody the first time you talk to them. Somebody I know said, okay, think of it this way. If you meet somebody on the street, are you going to ask them to marry you? Like, that just doesn't make any sense. Well, this is kind of the same thing. And what I suggest to people is, and William, this you might already be doing this. When someone sends me a direct message, I will go look at their profile. I want to know, you know, he went through the thought and effort of sending an actual personal thank you. And I think that's really awesome that you did that. The unfortunate thing is you've come up against someone that is only there to try and further themselves. And quite often, I think Trish can speak to this, but quite often you'll find that people that are in desperate times don't know, they lose sight of all boundaries. They just don't realize that that's not appropriate. But this happens so much on other platforms. When someone connects with you and then they send you a pitch for what you do, it's like, hello, do you even know who I am? Yes. you know, yeah. you asked to connect with me. Well, if you don't know that I'm social media, then you can't have looked at my profile, because it's just about everywhere. It's almost stamped on my forehead. Okay. And I got one the other day on Twitter. Oh yeah. Like we're happy to see what we can do for you in social. Uh-huh. Well, guess yep. what? You're not going to be hearing from me anytime soon.
Well, and I love this one. Oh, my name is whatever their name is. My name is John yeah. Smith. What's yours? What? What's yeah. your name? Okay. You're sending me yeah. a direct message, but you don't know my name.
Don't know my name. You're blocked now.
Yeah.
Now I know, Trish, and we've laughed about this, because I have a first name for a last name. So I'm Elaine Lindsay. So people sometimes call me Lindsay. It happens. Yeah. It happens in real life, because, you know, people aren't always good with names. But I had one individual contact me on Facebook. There were, I think we had 60 or 70 people in common. And I really looked at the profile and thought, okay, I get it. You're a business person. All right, I'll friend you. So I accepted the friend request, and I always send a message after, or I'll write on your profile, you know, thank you for reaching out in friendship. You know, are you a business person? Do you use this platform for business? I got a message back that said, "Dear Lindsay, I do all kinds of social media, and I can help you with whatever it is that you do."
Block.
So I wrote back and then unfriended. But I wrote back calling the person by his last name and said, obviously, when you don't take the time to even look at someone's profile, friending me cannot have been that important. Yeah. Thanks very much. Have a great day.
Oh,
you don't necessarily have to block people, because frankly, we all make mistakes, and I'm the queen of making mistakes. I'm not a great typist. I have a bad habit of saying I'm not a great typist. Don't want to be a good typist, if I'm honest. And, you know, sometimes you can make a mistake. People Absolutely. Can make a mistake and call people by their last name. One person I met, I called her by her last name in response. And after a few seconds, she realized what had happened. And, you know, we laugh about it to this day. There's always room for error. But this particular one, it was so blatantly obvious that there was no interest here in who the human being was. It was simply, can I get another sale? Okay, that's where the issue lies. Very seldom, actually, do I block people. I am, however, on LinkedIn very, very strict about who I engage with, because I'm not there to chat with you about what I did on the weekend. Okay, it's really, quite frankly, none of anybody's business unless they're friends with me. And LinkedIn is much more of building business relationships. It would not be appropriate to go into your doctor's office and ask him what he did Saturday night or what she did Saturday night. It's really none of your business. So LinkedIn is a much more professional social platform. In fact, the only professional social platform. There, you have to be even more particular and really be aware of your boundaries. We're still going to find people that don't get it. And there's always going to be that. So William, yeah, I'm not saying you have to block everyone. If someone is offensive to you, and you ask for some kind of apology, or something has been said that's really incorrect, and you reach out for some kind of response and don't get one or get something rude back, then yeah, go ahead and block them. Absolutely. And I'll say one last thing before I stop talking, Trish.
Okay.
You'll find me laugh. William, on Twitter, I have two lists that are public that people can see. And one is called Selly Selly No No, and the other one is called No to Buying Followers. Anybody who has the, you know, buy Twitter followers for $29 or buy whatever, when they connect with you, they go right on that public list. that's basically a really quick and easy way to stop people from, you know, joining or adding you as their following on Twitter when all they're trying to do is basically sell people. They're not real people. How do you find that out? Whatever platform, go check out their profile. That's bottom line. Yeah.
So I think I block a lot quicker than you do. I will block anybody who steps over my lines for intimacy. And that's my lines. And you're the only one who can define what those lines are. So it very clearly says on my profile that I'm married. So anytime I get someone who says, I would like to, you know, you're beautiful and I would like to get to know you better and, you know, and, you know, and get to know who you are. And I think every female person on Facebook is getting those. I don't care if you're, you know, 5 years old and you have an account so you could talk to your grandmother, or if you're 1,000 years old and you don't know how to do your own email, you're getting those. And I block them instantly. If someone sends me, if I connect with someone in whatever format that is, and the first thing I get back is a sales pitch, I block them because they're not connecting with me. And I totally agree with the idea that people can make mistakes. It's pretty obvious. You know, it's pretty obvious. I do not block people who have an auto reply. So if I, you know, someone follows me and I follow them back because you've trained me, I follow them back. And what I get is an autoresponder. Thanks for following me. Here's our deal of the week. I don't block that because that's not something they sent me by choice. That's something they've got set up in some sort of autoresponder that the minute someone follows them, they say, oh, look, here's our special. I don't have a problem with that.
But they did set that autoresponder up.
I totally agree. And they should talk to you and they should learn their social media from you instead. and not do that. However, I don't take that personally. Right?
Right, right. And that's a good thing. Not taking it personally is a very good thing.
Well, and this is it. But, it, you know, if you send someone a personal message and they send you back a sales pitch, I'd block them. And I'm, yeah. I'm clearly, yeah. I'm more heavy-handed with the blocking than you are. That's okay. You're also, yeah. you know, you're the one who taught me don't just accept the friend request. Go check them, you know, go ask them why first. And I wasn't doing that.
Absolutely.
So maybe that's why I became more heavy-handed blocking. you weren't discerning up front.
Yeah, but there's nothing wrong with that. And that,
absolutely.
You know, if that's how you choose to handle it, then absolutely go for it. And there's a lot of people that are just at the saturation point. They're fed up. Okay, like especially Facebook, where you are getting a lot of people signing up. They're not real accounts. And, you know, most women I know to click on an image or click on the name. You can Google the name and find out if it's a real person or, you know, if it's just a picture they're using from somewhere. You're going to find those kind of what I call jerky accounts on every platform that's out there. There's a lot of, you know, trolling that goes on. There's a lot of people that I guess have nothing better to do. So as long as you're sort of aware of what's out there, and I'm a firm believer in your intentions. If your intentions are good, you're not going to have all that. You're going to be so proud of me because I learned this from you. If your intentions are that you're going to have good interaction with good people, you're not going to get the, you know, the horrific trolls and the terrible interactions with people and inappropriate pictures and what have you, because you're not attracting that to yourself, right?
Yes, I also believe that I teach you to have good intentions. I also teach you to protect yourself, to have strong and healthy boundaries and to protect yourself. And sometimes the universe allows you to have a checkpoint, you know, just test your boundaries. I think it's important for people to understand I get invited to so many events, and those are not trolls. Those are people who are genuinely having events, and
yeah.
And what they do is they send out a blanket invitation to the whole world. And they're not pausing to think, am I inviting people to my event? You know, it would be like someone say inviting you to a class on social media. Oh, I'm offering this special deal class on social media, and they invite you. Really?
People have.
I know they have, because they invite every single person they're connected to. They invite every single person, and I don't reply to those. I don't reply to them. I consider them a little bit lazy, because you can make a list.
Yeah.
And I think in every single platform you can make a list and say, I will send these invitations to the people on the list. You know, the other thing I find frustrating is people will start groups of some kind. And the group will be given some grandiose name. So I'm thinking, let's give people hugs, you know, some grandiose name like that. And you think, oh, that's lovely. That's a lovely thought. But if you go and look at the group, it's a sales platform.
Yeah.
And I have a problem with that too, because I have a business page. I have business pages. You've taught me well. I have business pages, and that's what they are. They're business pages. This is what I do. You know, these are the events that I have. Here's some stuff. You know, I have lots of articles I'd love you to go read, you know, all that kind of stuff. I'm not pretending this is anything except what it is.
But I think the problem is, and where, I guess, where people fall down, if you will, on this, is that there are more who don't know, more who are lacking the common courtesy elements or the common etiquette elements. That's why we have etiquette teachers. That's why, you know, the books are out there, and you know, we don't have Dear Abby anymore, but you know, whoever took over for her, there is still a need. And with every new generation, you know, I think we tried to do things different than our parents, and our kids are trying to do different than we did. And I think that's just how it works as humans. But I think at some point we've thrown the baby out with the bathwater, and people have lost the consideration for common courtesy. They've actually, you know, removed what was really, really important. And I think that's a problem. I don't think that's a good thing. I think that's actually, that's giving us some serious issues by not having, you know, sort of rules and regulations and having it set out within the social sphere of what is and isn't acceptable. What should you be doing? And people who, I mean, I teach social media. I do that with my clients because I believe, you know, just think about how you feel. Okay. If you want to make people feel good because, you know, put yourself in a situation, how would you feel about getting a message like that? You know, if you really think about it, you wouldn't do it because you wouldn't want it. And that's where, you know, I started the top of the hour. We're talking about Scott Monty and his new Flipboard thing, the Full Monty. And the fact is, authenticity and relevant quality information is really what people are looking for. And as we get more and more savvy, I don't want to use the term savvy because I think consumers are very, very savvy, but more demanding in our requirements, as we up the ante for what we should be getting, you're going to see a drop off of that old style, you know, the old marketing that was aimed at the lowest common denominator.
I like the higher standard. I like consumers demanding more. I like
Yeah.
that. And
Well, yeah, and that's exactly what we're seeing. You know, and well, my husband thinks I'm crazy, and it was awesome yesterday. I talked about this, and my daughter-in-law made the same face I did the first time I heard this commercial. Okay, Coca-Cola has a commercial. A woman is on a plane, and she takes a sip of the Coke, and she's now at a party, and it starts singing, "You're so cute, I want to wear you like a suit."
see,
Okay,
that's why
and yeah, maybe I'm
your family has a
weird,
flipper, right? That's why people
but
flip
that
channels.
has like serial killer overtones to me. I don't think that's a great marketing thing. I just want to say hi, Steve. Good to see you. Steve has come to another blab that I do, so I definitely want to say hi. And yeah, Coca-Cola is not going to be happy with me, and I'm really sorry. But "You're so cute, I want to wear you like a suit." To
Yep, serial
me,
killer.
that just has such bad visual images. Not what I would want anybody to be singing or thinking,
And I
you
think they could
know? And
afford test marketing.
yeah, you
You
know, my
know?
husband said, "No, it's kind of cute. It's a song." Well, if it's a song, I don't know who's singing it, but you might start digging up their backyard because, like, geez. Yeah, sorry. I know. I'm being very opinionated this morning.
You're loud. That's the whole point.
Yeah.
So,
Yeah.
I think that it is absolutely true that having a positive intention can affect what you attract. I think that it is absolutely appropriate to be very, very conscious of your boundaries. And there's also the issue that, having a positive intention and having positive energy can actually attract people who are drawn to that, don't necessarily know how to interact with it.
Yeah.
Don't necessarily know how to interact with it. And I'm it's interesting because I'm extremely tolerant in many ways, but I have really clear boundaries. Really clear boundaries. One of the things that you're doing in social media is that you're standing in a crowd. Okay? So if you think of your personal interactions, if you go have dinner at a friend's house, they're your friends. If you go, visit family, they're your family, and you probably know something about them. Social media is the equivalent of hanging out at the mall. Okay? There's strangers, there's n not the filters that you would put in place in your personal life. And so you have to realize that you're in public and therefore you're interacting with people you don't know how they're going to behave. And chances are that you wouldn't sort of stand on a soapbox in the middle of the mall and tell everybody your business. Well, somebody said to me the other day, people post these pictures saying, "Here we are at the airport, leaving on our vacation. Oh, good. Nice to let, the burglars know that you're leaving," right? Because people just don't think. So, you said, would you put it on the front page of the paper? Would you stand on a box in the mall and announce it to everybody there?
No, and that's such a good point, and I think part of the problem, and part of why, all the Stop Bullying campaigns and all of that's going on, same kind of thing. People feel at one removed when you're behind your computer, your smartphone, your tablet, whatever. There's a bit of a disconnect. You'll find that in video chats, Blab, Zoom, Hangouts on air, Skype, whatever, you're going to get sort of a better idea of what people are really like because it's all on display. When you can hide behind text only, when the people that are there for not the right purpose, they're not interested in quality, they're not interested in truly building a relationship with people. You put up a photo of whatever, or, you know, maybe using a celebrity's photo, or, you know, people that catfish and all that kind of thing. There is no accountability when you have that wall. So this is actually, I think we're going to see more and more of, you know, this, the video type chatting. And eventually, I honestly believe, I don't know, 5, maybe more years down the road, I think all social will actually be in a format that engages all the senses. And for me who hates to type, oh, yay, that can't come fast enough. But I really do, you know, like I think as we become more savvy, as consumers up the bar for what they'll accept, then I think more and more people, marketers, you know, business people, you have to be real in not just what you're putting out, but you have to be real in how you not only build the relationship, but maintain the relationship.
So know to, how me, to me, the first thought that popped into my mind was, you know, parents are already struggling with how to teach their kids to interact on social media and to have boundaries that kids are not necessarily already ready to establish. They don't know how. That's going to make it even more complicated. And that means that as a parent, if you're concerned about that, then you have to start thinking about the kids' boundaries offline. Because if you, you know, if you help them establish strong boundaries offline, that'll automatically play out online.
But it, yeah, and I think it's like anything, the first rush, and it sounds silly, but, you know, we're in some cases 11 years in. LinkedIn's been around 2003, they started. Some of the social media has been around forever, but it only became truly mainstream like 2010, 2011, you know, all more and more people were realizing that there was a business edge here. You could actually use this for business. And as the numbers go up and more businesses are using more social channels, you know, not just LinkedIn, people are realizing that, yeah, somebody, like somewhere, we have to lay out a structure. Because we have no one to blame but ourselves. If our kids don't know what their boundaries are, if they don't understand what common courtesy and common sense is, then we need to look to ourselves. Like, where did we fall down? Because, you know, they're learning things somewhere. It's not just osmosis.
Well, you know, there's a backlash effect there. Because we went through a generation that taught their children that authority isn't all powerful to protect their children from abuse. That's what happened. So you have all of these people who said, I'm not having my child abused by an authority figure. So they said, okay, break the rules. You know, break the rules. This doesn't apply. You don't have to do what people say. You don't have to follow all these rules. And like any pendulum effect, and it is a pendulum effect, like any pendulum effect, it has to swing back the other way. And so
I'm gonna stop you for 1 second because we've got a good question. Steve, this is great. He's asking what percentage of people on social media that we come across still don't know how to behave. Well, I'm probably gonna get hammered for this. and oh well. But I'm going to say there's more than 60%, to be honest. If I was to turn sideways now and go through a feed, pop up any social channel, I guarantee you that 60% of what I'm seeing on a business page or on a bit is not really adhering to, you know, good etiquette, good common sense, all of those things. And it's really hard for those that put out the social channels to kind of handle that because you can only police these things so much. And he's saying it doesn't surprise him. Yep. Okay. Yeah. It's not even that the new joiners are clueless. We were saying to me, it's that we haven't really given them a structure to be able to understand what's required. And I have a friend in the States, you know, shout out to Mark Babbitt, CEO of U-Turn. He deals with millennials and we have a new one too. It's not just Generation Z. We have the Alpha Kids.
So okay.
Scott Monty brought this up. Alpha Kids cracked me up this morning. They're 0 to 2. Oh. Okay, like think about that. Here we are with yet another generation that's going to have, you know, even more in the way of challenges and what have you, because this next generation, they don't know anything that isn't technology. Like wrap your head around that. So yeah, the millennials in areas such as U-Turn, they're trying to help the millennials that didn't get enough from their parents and their grandparents about what is required in a business setting. And I'm certainly not blaming them, because some of these kids came right out of the gate. You've got millionaires and multimillionaires that are 20 and 22 and 24 years old. They barely know who they want to date. They don't understand, you know, all this common courtesy, and they never had time for that. They were busy buried in building apps or whatever they were doing with these wonderful, brilliant brains, but no one took the time when they were younger to put the other pieces in place. And I firmly believe that's up to our parents even still. And you're right about the authority thing. Yeah, we all went the other way so far that, you know, our kids have a disdain for authority. They think the government's useless. Well, hello. Okay, millennials came into a world where topsy-turvy, the corporations were right, left, and center were ripping people off. They, you know, going into bankruptcy because they'd done things incorrectly. Not the best place to be. And these millennials come in and it's like, well, great. Why the hell would I want to do any of that or listen to any of them? Or, hey, I totally get it. And it makes it difficult when it doesn't start in the home. So that's partly, Steve, why I said such a high number. And it's unfortunate. It really is unfortunate. Yeah, and exactly. You know, and Steve, I know you're younger, and he's, yeah, why should I listen to them? Well, it's our parents, and I know me not wanting my kids to be harmed. Yeah, I think we instilled in them a bit of a disrespect of authority. Well, I know in my case. and not wanting to just go with the status quo.
It's not just about harm. It's about raising kids to be more discerning in the workplace, you know, to like not take crap from the boss, you know, and not let the boss abuse them. So it isn't just fear of that white van, you know, it's also taking, having stronger boundaries for yourself in the world.
Yeah.
Because there's been a whole social switch from, you know, doing whatever it takes for the job to quality of life.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, we're not saying there's anything wrong with that, because there isn't. I think it's awesome. I love the fact that, you know, now for millennials, don't ask them what they want to do in life. It's like, how do you want to affect the world? You know, what is it you'd like to change? It's not about, you know, what job do you want to get and stay there until you get your gold watch and die. That doesn't exist anymore.
Exactly.
Okay. Everything has changed so much. But to me, it's every generation goes through that, not us, you know, our parents did that, so we're not doing it. And we've gone so far down that rabbit hole and opened up so much in a global way. Social media has allowed us to connect with virtually anyone, anywhere, including the space station. I used to tell people, you know, in 2011, 2012, it was like, okay, you know, it's great. You can connect anywhere in the world. Well, now it's even outside the world.
Exactly.
That has, you know, it has been its own double-edged sword, because we don't take the time necessarily to understand all the other cultures. We don't take the time to teach our kids that either. You know, everybody, oh, I don't have the time for that. We're all flying by the seat of our pants. And I think if more people, maybe our age, and there, believe it or not, there's people older than me. but if people took the time to maybe have a real conversation with someone a couple of generations younger in a not condescending way, sort of explain what we think is valid, what we think is useful, and then allow them to tell us the same thing. I think that could help us out a lot.
Well, and another point, which you just segued into so perfectly, is when you're talking cross-culturally, you don't know what's offensive. So I was sitting chatting with a girlfriend of mine from India, and I dropped my shoes and folded my feet up under me. And she said, okay, so I'm going to tell you this because you don't know, and I know you. You know, you wouldn't do this. But she said, you know, in my culture, letting someone see the sole of your feet is rude. So I promptly put my feet down. She said, you know, it's not a problem. Like, if you sit comfortably. I said, no, I'm not doing that. But I had no idea. And so now, it's challenging enough because we live in multicultural societies. But now, we're interacting with people around the world, and we don't know what courteous means to them. We have no idea. So in addition to the fact that we have this sort of backlash effect because we wanted our kids to take care of themselves, we now have also this, you know, multicultural effect where, you know, what is courtesy? Who knows what that means?
And the funny thing is, even when we think we're doing right, and every generation thinks they're trying to do better for the next. I can remember my daughter was, I think, late teens, maybe 20. And we were having a heated discussion about something. And I basically said, well, Mr. So-and-so, like, you need to respect him. And she turned around and she said to me, Why? Because he's older? And it really took me aback, because I'd been brought up in a generation where I still call my parents' friends by their last name. You know, it would never occur to me to call them by their first name, because that's not how I was brought up. And I was so taken aback that I didn't have an answer for her, because I'm thinking, well, like, how dare you ask me that? And realized she dared because I had given her that, you know, our boundaries were, you can tell me what you think. You can tell me what you want. And realized, obviously too late, that I shot myself in the foot by trying to, you know, go one better than my parents. And to me, the psychology of it all is really fascinating.
You know, that's my department. So the other thing that occurred to me is, you know, we have all of these kids who have a primary interaction of texting. Now I have adult children, so I'm pretty good at texting. The thing is, they started texting and it was something that belonged to the kids, not to us. You know, we came into it after the fact to communicate with our kids. Okay. And it was their way of being private. They could have a conversation that people couldn't overhear. Okay. And so this mentality was created of privacy and sharing, and it belonged to them. And I don't think they understood that when they did the same thing on Twitter, it wasn't private.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that's such a good point. Yeah.
And it is. And this is the key, is that they have this mentality of interaction with technology that is really different than ours.
Yeah.
And they haven't paused and said, what do I want to put out there? You know, how do I want to interact? You know, there's been all kinds of problems with kids having trouble being bullied online and things like that. And I think this is really something that has exploded because they haven't thought about it and they don't know. And the thing that, you know, if you sort of picture that high school corridor and, you know, people walking down the corridor and snippy comments that happen, and they do, you know, the snippy comments that happen. I mean, that's nasty and it hurts people and they feel bad, but it isn't in print and it's over.
Yeah.
It isn't in print and it's over. So the same person who would do the snippy comment to you walking down the hall will do the snippy comment online, not realizing how much they've escalated.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's funny because my father is on Facebook, and I got on Facebook. Well, I said this at a networking meeting. They put it out there on Saturday, and it's true. I started on Facebook the minute they opened the doors to people outside of college so that I could stalk my children, because it annoyed the hell out of them that I would phone every day to see how they were. This was a way that I could see they hadn't been in a horrific car accident, their life was not ended, yada, yada, without overtly bugging them all the time. And then, you know, because I realized that it was a good business tool, I surpassed both my kids in social, which is why this is what I do today. But what was interesting to me was my kids, my eldest grandchild is 21, and her friends talk on Facebook, and I look at it and I'm just like mortified. Even by my own kids, it's like, hey, your granddad can see that. Can you not put a muzzle on it? Okay, don't put so much out there. And my daughter's answer to me as a teen, I would ask her questions, and God forgive me, I told her, don't you ever lie to me. So she'd answer my questions. And then I'd freak out and she'd say, Mom, you taught me not to lie to you. So if you don't want the answer, don't ask the question. Yes. And it's basically the same thing, only magnified a gazillion times, because it's out there in print or photos or what have you for everyone to see.
Yes.
And you know, you probably had one too. Everybody had the aunt who thought their kids were wonderful. They never did anything wrong and blah, blah, blah. And now you can't do that. The aunts can't do that because you can see exactly what their kids and the nephews and the cousins are doing because they are on social media. So it's a funny balance that we need to work, because some of it's good in that you're showing up and people can ask for help, which I think is phenomenal. There's a lot of groups and a lot of places out there that our young people can actually open up and talk about things that we couldn't. You know, mental illness is no longer a hidden sore subject. People actually talk about it and can be more involved and helpful. Look at the Let's Talk Bell Day last week here in Canada. For every tweet, 5 cents went to their charity fundraising, and it's all about mental health. There's a lot of good being done. So I just don't want us to, God, we're over an hour. I don't want us to sort of end on a note where we're bashing everything bad, because that's not it at all. Okay.
Absolutely.
There's a lot of good has come out of this, but I think what we need to do is be more vocal, more on point about helping people understand their own need for boundaries, their own need, as you said, to make the decision to share what you're sharing, to do what you're doing. We need people to really think before they do all these things.
That's right.
Is that too much to ask?
That they think? Well, if they're going to raise the bar for us, then maybe we should raise the bar for them.
So on that note of bar raising, yeah, it's not all bad. Interesting discussion. I hope someone got some value out of us today. This is Patricia Wall, known to me as Trish of TTLO Inc., and I'm Elaine Lindsay of Trill Social Media. And it really was a pleasure talking with you, Trish, and with Steve and William and Tiffany and the other people that were here today. Thanks very much, and we'll see people next Monday.
Take care.
And on that
Bye-bye.
note, I will stop our recording.